Thank you for moving down. We really appreciate it. We have to get started to fit everybody in, so. Okay, everybody, welcome to World Poetry Week for the upper school. Thank you. I'm Mr. Sawyer, and we're celebrating the power of the written word. Words can change lives. And we have a picture of Kurt Vonnegut and Andy Warhol, I think. And they said, make poetry, make art. It doesn't matter if people, I think we have that picture, right, Mr. David? There we go. That it doesn't matter if people like it or not, just keep making art. It will enrich your life and it will touch the lives of others. So I'm gonna start out with a poem that some of you guys said you liked, and this is something I wrote a while ago called Driving in the Rain. Okay? The rain growing up always seemed harder and more frightening than fascinating as it pummeled the windshield. You couldn't see, and for a moment you held your breath and opened your eyes as wide as they would open. Dad would have to pull over. Thousands of flashing jets and wiggling wires, ricocheting and glancing and pounding and plopping for long gray minutes. The sound of it on the plexiglass and on the hood, seen steaming there and tap, tap, tapping on the roof like heavy nails dropping from somewhere nearby. And the engine shimmying quietly in neutral, little rivers rushing around the tires, traffic lights changing for no one, and car horns muted in the fog and spray, no one talking. Just damp breath on the windows and the quiet taffy snap of the backs of your thighs separating from the back seat's vinyl as you fussed and fidgeted. You couldn't see, but it was all right. No one would wash away. You were safe. There was clarity of a kind. It never rains like that anymore, heavy enough to make you pull over and wait. It never envelops you or embraces you or stops you dead in your tracks. You just drive through it and turn your wipers up and up, struggling to keep your direction true and keep going. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to introduce the first student reader and remind everybody to speak up, like I'm doing. Look up every once in a while, because then you connect with your audience, and take your time, slow down, okay? Let's have Lynn Moon and Alex Lee, grade 9.
Today we're going to read a poem called Solitude by Ella Wheeler Wilcox. Laugh and the world laugh at you. Weep and the weep alone. For the sad old earth must borrow its mirth, but has trouble enough of its own. Sing and the hills will answer. Sign it is lost on the air. The echoes bound to a joyful sound, but shrink from voicing care.
Rejoice, and men will seek you. Grieve, and they turn and go. They want full measure of all your pleasure, but they do not need your all. Be glad, and your friends are many. Be sad, and you lose them all. There are none of the kind your nectared wine, but alone you must drink life's gall.
Feast, and your halls are crowded. Fast, and the world goes by. Succeed and give, and it helps you leap, but no man care can help you die.
There is room in the halls of pleasure for a long and lordly train, but one by one we must all file on through the narrow aces of pain.
Thank you.
Okay, Joshua Chen, grade 9.
Okay, so this is a Chinese poem by Li Bai. Maybe some of you know. Okay, so this is in English. Do you not see the yellow river come from the sky, rushing into the sea and never come back? Do you not see the mirrors bright in the chamber side? Grieve over your snow white hair, though once it was silk black. When hopes are won, oh, drink your fill in high delight, and never leave your wine cup empty in the moonlight. Heaven has made us talent, we are not made in vain. 1,000 gold coins spent, more will turn up again. Kill a cow, cook a sheep, and let us merry be, and drink 300 cups full of wine in high glee. Dear friend of mine, cheer up, I invite you to wine. I will sing you a song, please hear, oh hear, lend me a willing ear. What difference will rare and costly dish make? I only want to get drunk and never wake up. How many great men were forgotten throughout the age, but great drinkers are more famous than sober sage. The prince of poets feasted in his palace at will, drank wine at 10,000 a case, and left his fill. A host should not complain of money he is short. To drink with you, I will sell things of any sort. My fur coat's worth 1,000 coins of gold, and my flower dappled horse may be sold. To buy good wines that we may drown the whole age old.
Our next reader is Samuel Han, grade 10.
Okay, so today I'm going to read a really short poem made by Tupac Shakur, "The Rose That Grew From Concrete." Did you hear about the rose that grew from a crack in the concrete, proving nature's law is wrong? It learned to walk without having feet. Funny it seems, but by keeping its dreams, it learned to breathe fresh air. Long live the rose that grew from concrete, when no one else ever cared.
Okay, next is Evie Chang and Yvonne Nien. Let's give him a hand. Oh, here we go.
Thank you. Identity.
By Julio Noboa. Let them be as flowers, always watered, fed, guarded, admired, but harnessed to a pot of dirt. I'd rather be a tall, ugly weed, clinging on cliffs like an eagle, wind wavering above high, jagged rocks, to have broken through the surface of stone, to live, to feel exposed to the madness of the vast, eternal sky, to be swayed by the breeze of an ancient sea, carrying my soul, my seed beyond the mountains of time, or into the abyss of the bizarre.
I'd rather be unseen, and if, then shunned by everyone, than to be a pleasant-smelling flower, growing in clusters in the fertile valley, where they're praised, handled, and plucked by greedy human hands. I'd rather smell of musty green stench than of sweet, fragrant lilac. If I could stand alone, strong and free, I'd rather be a tall, ugly weed. Thank you.
I'm a big hand. Thank you, girls. And our next speaker is Po-Yu Chen, grade 11. Thank you, girls. Po-Yu Chen, grade 11. Oh, wait a minute. Alysha and Latisha, right? Sorry. Alysha and Latisha. All right. Thank you, girls.
Hi, everyone. We're Latisha from grade 11. So the poem we're reading today is 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird by Woolen Stevens.
Among 20 snowy mountains, the only moving thing was the eye of the blackbird.
It was of three minds, like a tree, in which there are three blackbirds.
The blackbird whirled in the autumn winds. It was a small part of the pantomime.
A man and a woman are one. A man and a woman and a blackbird are one.
I do not know which to prefer, the beauty of inflections or the beauty of innuendos. The blackbird whistling, or just after.
Icicles filled the long windows with barbaric gas, the shadow of the blackbird, crossed it and forth, the mood traced in the shadow, an insipid probe cause.
O thing men of Haddam, why do you imagine golden birds? Do you not see how the blackbird walks around the feet of the woman about you?
I know noble accents and lucid, imperceptible rhythm, but I know too that a blackbird is involved in what I know.
When the blackbird flew outside, it marked the edge of one of many circles.
At the sight of blackbird flying in the green light, even the brown of asphalt would cry out sharply.
He rode over Connecticut in a glass once a fear pierced him in that he mistook the shadow of his equipage for blackbirds.
The river is moving. The blackbird must be flying.
It was evening all afternoon. It was snowing, and it was going to snow. The blackbird sat in the cedar limbs.
Thank you.
Okay, great job, Latisha. All right, our next readers are Warren Wang and Jeffrey Lin, grade 10. Okay.
Hi, everyone. We'll be reading The Lesson of a Moth by John Marquis. Yeah, we'll be reading The Lesson of a Moth by Don Marquis. I was talking to a moth the other evening. He was trying to break into an electric light bulb and fry himself on the wires. Why do you fellows pull a stunt? I asked him. Because it is so conventional thing for moths, or why? If lead had been an uncovered candle instead of an electric light bulb, you'd now be a small unsightly cinder. Have you no sense?
Plenty of it, he answered. But at times we get tired of using it. We get bored with the routine and crave beauty and excitement. Fire is beautiful, and we know that if we get too close, it will kill us. But what does that matter? It is better to be happy for a moment and be burned up with beauty than to live a long time and be bored all the while. So we wet all our life up into one little roll, and then we shoot the roll. That is what life is for. It is better to be a part of beauty for one instant and then cease to exist than to exist forever and never be a part of beauty. Our attitude toward life is come easy, go easy. We are like human beings used to be before they became too civilized to enjoy themselves.
and before I could argue him, out of his philosophy, he went and immolated himself on a patent cigar lighter. I do not agree with him myself. I would rather have half the happiness and twice the longevity. But at the same time, I wish there was something I wanted as badly as he wanted to fry himself.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, thank you guys, great job. All right, Emily Tsaur and Cindy Yang, grade 10, are our next readers. Let's give them a big hand.
The Tide Rises, The Tide Falls by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow.
The tide rises.
The tide falls.
The twilight darkens.
The curlew calls.
Along the sea sands damp and brown.
The traveler hastens towards the town.
And the tide rises.
The tide falls.
Darkness settles on roofs and walls.
But the sea and darkness calls.
The little waves with their soft white hands.
Efface the footprints in the sands.
And the tide rises.
The tide falls.
The morning breaks.
The steeds in their stalls.
Stamp and neigh.
As the hostler calls.
The day returns.
But nevermore.
Returns the traveler to the shore.
And the tide rises. The tide falls. Thank you.
All right. Very good, girls. Thank you very much. Okay, our next reader. I jumped the gun before. Po Yu Chen, grade 11. Let's give him a big hand.
Hello, I'm grade 11, Po Yuan. I'm going to read the poem by my fellow classmate, Jet Lim. It's called Timeless Night. Woo! 1 a.m., eyes closed, yet I'm still awake, silently waiting for dawn to break. Tired, yet can't fall asleep. Left alone with my thoughts so deep. I rub my eyes and open them to see the ebony sky over the quiet city. Streetlights, cityscapes, mesmerizing allow me to escape. A sliver of moon, so pale and bright, casts a silver veil over the night. I lean back into my seat. It's now 2 a.m., my clock reads. I resume my work, but to no avail. I close my eyes once more with an exhale, falling deeper into my thought and my dreams. The music in the background fits seamlessly. As I drift away into the night, the atmosphere holds onto me tight. I silently wish for the sun to ascend and softly make this eternal night end. Thank you.
Okay, our next reader is Emma Wang, grade 10. Emma Wang.
This is My Tentacles Await by Ting Tsai. Eat breakfast at dawn and the ground feels static, and I cannot reach where I used to jump from. The night resembles day and the day resembles night. And the scale reads the earth, and world sits on my sleeve. I'm unable to comprehend what I used to read. No, I cannot speak the language that I used to breathe. I fire destinations as I loathe and despair, and I cannot sense because I'm lost here somewhere. I'm a wet little octopus dressed in underwear. I am overly exposed and not exposed at all. An octopus in underwear? I've never heard of such a thing. Such an odd-looking creature. What is this thing? I drown in the water that I used to command, and now my eight tentacles are burnt in a pot. A pot of red potion, a pot of burning flames. What scent surrounds me is my own black perfume. I see a shift in dollars from green to monochrome, and I see a world self-destructive yet aims to survive in. A universe that is so undecorated and yet so undecorated. What void is this? That shall I avoid is. I was once lost, but I found a spare key. It was a key to a lock, and a lock locks something. And yet I have lost the key once again, so I must bestow it to me and chase to the very end. Thank you.
Okay, our next reader is Alan Kuo, grade 10. Let's give Alan a big hand.
Hello, I'm Alan. I'm gonna read two poems, and the first one is 93% Stardust by Nikita, Gill. We have calcium in our bones, iron in our veins, carbon in our souls, and nitrogens in our brains. 93% Stardust with souls made of flames. We are all just stars that have people names. Okay. And then I'm gonna read another one, Dreams by Langston Hughes. Hold fast to dreams, for if dreams die, life is a broken-winged bird that cannot fly. Hold fast to dreams, for when dreams go, life is a barren field frozen with snow. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Alan. And our next performer is Ting Tsai, grade 10. So she's going to set up.
Hello, everyone. I wrote this one last Friday. It's called Break the Standards. So, yeah, okay. Today is the best day ever. We broke 6,000 mirrors. So yesterday was the, sorry. Can you go with the presentation, like quick? I have lyrics. Yeah, thank you. Sorry. Okay, I'll start one more time. Okay. Today is the best day ever. We broke 6,000 mirrors. So yesterday was the best day ever. We gave 6,000 terrors, errors, tremors, favors, yeah. Wish the cars would drive and over. Wish the ship would never sink. In the van I used to dream of, with no heresy. Wish the breath would give me a token for the mind, cause it's incomplete. Block the stance, cause they're unspoken. I know that will defeat. Live, wanna fight because of that style. Wanna live, wanna fight, cause we gotta fight. Wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad. But don't wanna change, yes, don't wanna change, yes, don't want to. Wish the clock would be stopped from running. Wish you had too many sheep. In the world that's not on fire, the world's great defeat. Wish the door would not be broken for the pack, cause it's out of reach. Break the stance, cause they're unspoken. No, that will defeat. You know what? We don't have no luck. You know what? We're gonna need some luck. The world just needs some change. The world just needs some change. The world just needs some blah. Yeah. Really hang this trap, but the door right. It's coming down like slap, but it's gonna be fine, right? I'm right this time, right? Wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad, but I wanna change, just wanna change, just want to. We're the night, we're not happy. We're the night, with the world scares me. What do we fear? What do we fear ourselves tonight? Really hating this track, but it's alright. Slamming down like a slap, but it's gonna be fine, right? I'm right this time, am I? Wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad, but I wanna change, it's the wanna change, it's the want to. Someday, someday, be the best day ever. We'll bring in the change that matters. Someday, someday, be the best day ever. We'll give a smile instead of tears. Really hating this track, but it's alright. It's coming down like a slap, but it's gonna be fine, right? I'm right this time, am I? Wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad, wanna fight so bad, but I wanna change, it's the wanna change, but we got to.
Thank you.
Our next reader is Nicole Hwang, grade 10.
Surprise! It's not Nicole. Come on in, come on in, Esther. It's not Nicole, it's Esther.
Oh, it's Esther. Okay, it's not Nicole.
Okay. So I'm going to read the Acquainted with the Night by Robert Frost. So I have been one acquainted with the night. I have walked out in rain and back in rain. I have outwalked the furthest city light. I have looked down the saddest city lane. I have passed by the watchman on his beat and dropped my eyes, unwilling to explain. I have stood still and stopped the sound of feet when far away an interrupted cry came over houses from another street, but not to call me back or say goodbye. And further still at an unearthly height, one luminary clock against the sky proclaimed the time was neither wrong nor right. I have been one acquainted with the night. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Esther. And we have Karen next. Karen, and we're back on schedule. Karen Dang, grade 10.
Life is too short to wake up in the morning with regrets. So love the people who treat you right. Forgive the ones who don't and believe that everything happens for a reason. If you get the chance, take it. If it changes your life, let it. Nobody said it will be easy. They just promised it will be worth it. From Dr. Seuss.
Thank you very much, Karen. Great job. All right, next we have Morrison and Jed doing a song. Hopefully we have Morrison and Jed. They're next. Come on down. Microphone set up. You need two mics? Are you good? Oh, here you go. And there's one for your guitar.
Hello, everyone. My name is Morrison and he is Jet. And today we are going to sing a song called Fast Car. And this song is meaningful because it talks about many, like, how do you say? Okay, so we know this song from the American Dream Unit. And so this song is basically talking about some helplessness of an African-American woman. Yeah, thank you.
You got a fast car, I want a ticket to anywhere. Maybe we make a deal, maybe together we can get somewhere. Any place is better. Starting from zero, got nothing to lose. Maybe we'll make something. Me, myself, I got nothing to lose. You got a fast car, I got a plan to get us out of here. I've been working in the convenience store. Man, I just saved just a little bit of money. Won't have to get too far. Just cross the border and into the city. Ooh, and I can both get jobs and finally see what it means to be living. See, my old man's got a problem. He lives to the bottle and the working at a convenience store. Man, I just saved just a little bit of money. Won't have to drive too far and cross the border and end into the city. I said somebody's got to take the Crisco, and that's what I did. You got a fast car, is it fast enough so you can fly away? We gotta make a decision, leave tonight or live and die this way. So I remember we were driving in your car. Speed so fast it felt like I was drunk. City lights laid out before us, and your arm felt nice wrapped around my shoulder. And I had a feeling that I belong. I had a feeling I could be someone. You got a fast car, is it fast enough so you can fly away? You gotta make a decision, stay tonight or live and die this way.
Great job, guys. Next up we have Austin Lowe, grade 10.
Hello. Do not stand at my grave and weep, by Mary Elizabeth Fry. Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. I'm a thousand winds that blow. I'm the diamond glints on snow. I'm the sun on ripened grain. I'm the gentle autumn rain. When you awaken in the morning's hush, I'm the swift uplifting rush of quiet birds in circle of flight. I'm the soft stars that shine at night. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I'm not there. I do not die. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Austin. Great job. Next up, we have Ruby Wu, grade 10. Do not go gentle into that good night.
Do not go gentle to that good night by Dylan Thomas. Do not go gentle into that good night. Oh, age shall burn and rave at the close of day. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Lo, wise men at their end, no dark is right. Because their word had forked no lining, they did not go gentle into that good night. Good men, the last wave by, crying how brightly frail deeds might have danced in a green bay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men who cause and sun the sun in flight, and learn too late, they grieve it on its way. Do not go gentle into that good night. Grave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyed could blaze like a meteor and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying of a light. And you, my father, there on the set high, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears. I pray, do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of a light. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ruby. Now we have a poem from grade 11, Kitty Tseng, that she's only hours old. It's a brand new poem. All right, Kitty.
So this poem is called Yesterday I Lost a Piece of Me. Yesterday, I lost a piece of me. The brown swing, the bruised knee. Return to me, I come with a plea. My days of sheer ecstasy. Yesterday, I lost a piece of me. The rubber ducks bobbing in the sea, the fading warmth of evening tea. My hourglass holding infinity. Yesterday, I lost a piece of me. The pink wildflowers and honeybee, the rough-hewn door and golden key. My maze to nature's mystery. Yesterday, I lost a piece of me. The smell of books, everything homey, the blissful ignorance of he and she, my forever pleasant eternity. Yesterday, I lost a piece of me. The loving shade of a cypress tree, the comforting clouds of warm coffee, above my churning insanity. Come on, give it back to me. Time, you master thief, hurt you be. You took away my bliss, a part of me, the teenager in me, so wild and free. Yesterday, I lost a piece of me. Thank you.
All right, Kitty. All right, now we have Olivia Zhang, grade 12. And let's give her a big hand.
Sonnet 18, William Shakespeare. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's thief hath all too short a date. Sometime too hot the eye of heaven shines, and often is his gold complexion dimmed, and every fair from fair sometime declines, by chance or nature's changing course untrimmed. But lie eternal summer shall not fade, nor lose possession of that fair low host, nor shall death brag though wonders in his shade, when it internal lines to time low growth. So long as man can breathe or eyes can see, so long lives lease, and this gives life to thee.
Okay, thank you, Olivia. Our next student reader is Eva Ure, grade 12. Let's give her a big hand.
Okay. It is the darkest, deepest place one can travel to alone, a solo journey filled with struggles and groans. Every day is a new battle against the same foe, but the enemy fights back with psychological blows. It creeps up on you in your most vulnerable state, especially when there's no one around who can relate. Thoughts in your mind begin to swirl and swell, which drag you into your own subconscious hell. Figments and entities from your past serve as the pain, which you can't outlast. Finally, sleep always comes as a welcome friend, but the morning, the ceaseless battle begins yet again.
Okay, our next reader is Carmen Lee, grade 12. Carmen.
The art of losing is a hard to master. So many things seem filled with the intent. To be lost that you lose is no disaster. Lose something every day. Accept the fluster of lost door keys. The hour badly spent. The art of losing is a hard to master. Then practice losing further, losing faster. Places and names and where it was you meant to travel. None of these will bring disaster. I lost my mother's watch, and look, my last or next to last of three loved houses went. The art of losing is hard to master. I lost two cities, lovely ones, and vaster, some realms I owned. Two rivers, a continent. I missed them, but it wasn't a disaster. Even losing you, I should not have lied. It's evident that the art of losing, it's not too hard to master. Though it may look like, rightly like disaster.
Okay, thank you, Carmen. Our next reader is Melody Peng, grade 10.
You're so hard on yourself, but remember, everybody has a chapter they don't read out loud. Take a moment, sit back, marvel at your life, at the mistakes that gave you wisdom, at the suffering that gave you strength. Despite everything, you still move forward. Be proud of this. Continue to endure, continue to persevere. And remember, no matter how dark it gets, the sun will rise again. Thank you.
Thank you, Melody. And our next reader is Ang Sai, grade 10. Give him a big hand.
I am a piece by Mr. Sawyer. I am a piece of metal mated to plastic, a barrel, a bridge block, and a slide, a seven-round magazine waiting in the grip, and a fresh cartridge cocked. I am a piece pointing at a trembling young woman in Stanford who empties her ATM account on her lunch hour. I am a piece waving at a would-be actor outside a Hollywood party, a tight-lipped, indignant actor who used to be a Broadway dancer, an actor who would rather run than be robbed. Too bad. I am a piece elegantly firing, piercing his stomach and spleen. Inky blood seeps from his side. He gulps the air and begins to bleed for help. Last thing I hear is a shrill whistle charging footsteps and a swirl of solicitous voices. I am a piece fixing on a pink-faced federal marshal in Bonner's Ferry, a federal marshal with rifle drawn, bent on extradition, a federal marshal whose breath gets short as he trots in the dark, whose nostrils expel steaming cold fear as he dives for cover in the spiny grass. A federal marshal whose badge and belt and buttons and walkie-talkie all jerk in unison as he marks his way on scraped elbows and slithering knees across the parched earth. A federal marshal who will soon have a hero's welcome back in Boston, his friends in black armbands, already a finger warms my trigger. I am a piece, an extension of muscle and sinew and bone. I am a piece. Thank you.
Thank you, Ang. You did a great job. Our last reader is Will Hugh, grade 10. Come on down.
The peace of wild things by Wendell Berry. When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life and my children's life may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water, and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things, who do not tax their lives with foresight of grief. I come into presence of still water, and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting with their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free.
Okay, thank you, Will. And thank you to all our student readers. We had a great World Poetry Week celebration for the high school, and we have milk, tea, and cookies, and you have a couple of minutes to partake of that before block four. And thank you, everybody, for coming. It was a great, great celebration. Thanks a lot.
like my poem about the gun?